to this sermon on Easter Day. As we start, I'm going to pray the collect for this day. It goes like this: Lord of all life and power, who through the mighty resurrection of your Son overcame the old order of sin and death, to make all things new in him, grant that we, being dead to sin and alive to you in Jesus Christ, may reign with him in glory, to whom with you and the Holy Spirit be praise and honour, glory and might, now and in all eternity. Amen. The passage for today, for Easter Day, comes from Matthew chapter 28, verses 1 to 10. So if you'd like to pause the video at this stage and read that, it will help you understand what will come from this sermon. As a vicar, I've taken many funerals over the years, and what you begin to notice is that each one is different. As you walk with the bereaved, you quickly become aware of how they are managing that grief, and occasionally they are utterly consolable, and holding the deepest of emotional responses is really very hard. More often, there is a sense of humour about funerals and death and things like that. And at one burial, I listened as the family watched a crisp packet blow across the graveyard rather like tumbleweed. There was a chorus of comments saying, "There he is, we always knew he would turn up to his own funeral." There are many views about death, but as Christians, we surely must have something amazing to say about it. This is never more important than at the present moment in the history of our national life. So do we think that heaven is the vague domain somewhere up there and for the life beyond? Is our view of eternity that we escape the rigours of this world, the difficulty and the hardship, its brokenness and death? Is Easter Day just the happy ending in an otherwise difficult and dark 40-day period that closes with the sad story of Holy Week and ends with the cross? John Stott said, "Authentic Christianity is supernatural Christianity. It's not a tame and harmless ethic consisting of a few moral platitudes spiced with a dash of religion. It is rather a resurrection religion, a life lived by the power of God." This extended time of Lent, this coronavirus fast of all things normal, asks new questions of the church. It demands we search for what he is raising to new life after this season of death. The account of the resurrection begins with this simple yet profound phrase: "After the Sabbath, at the dawn, on the first day of the week." As the darkness lifted on that first day, was it just another normal day? The language of first day mirrors that of Genesis chapter 1 and verse 5, the new creation. But almost like a bookend, this chapter of Matthew concludes, "Behold, I am with you always to the end of the age." So this first sunrise heralded the beginning of a new age, making the resurrection more than just an extraordinary miracle or even a special favour to Jesus, but as God says in Revelation chapter 21 and verse 5, "Behold, I am making all things new." If this is the first day of the new age, when all things are being made new, then what is God going to do with the old creation? We hear that Mary Magdalene and the other Mary went to look at the tomb. These are our two witnesses. But what did they see? Or rather, what did they not see? They saw an empty tomb, guarded by some very frightened soldiers, carrying at the angel of the Lord with his earthquake. They might have expected a body to wash and embalm, to wrap and to tend. But to come to terms with the resurrection, they had to contend with the evidence of absence. "He is not here," says the angel in Matthew chapter 28 and verse 6. He who had physically died was now physically absent. If Jesus had died, and that was it, all you could argue from his later appearances would be that the disciples were either suffering group hallucinations or some sort of weird haunting. But that would depend on Jesus' body being found by the women in the tomb. They did not find him. Jesus' physical death on the cross and now his physical absence from the tomb demonstrates that the nature of death, the nature of creation, and the nature of eternity had fundamentally changed. In the old creation, God created sheer beauty out of absolutely nothing, and we call this ex nihilo. It means out of nothing. On the first day of the new creation, God has not disregarded the beauty of that old creation. Rather, he creates something out of the old, ex vetere, out of the old. And we know this because Jesus' old body was not there, but it had become the physical template for his resurrection body. Otherwise, the disciples would not have recognized him. What that does that then mean for us when we die? It means I will not become some cosmic crisp packet of a disembodied soul blowing in the wind at my funeral. The Easter story of God's grace and the marvellous indwelling of the Holy Spirit mean that I will not remain naked in death as some disembodied spark flying off into the ether. That is a form of Platonism. It is a Greek myth, not a Christian doctrine. No, we will be raised to new life after death. We will be physical and recognisable again. I know this because Jesus was raised to life in a new body that was created from his old body. And the deposit of God's Spirit in our lives now guarantees that transformation. Praise the Lord. Hebrews chapter 12 and verse 2 encourages to look to Jesus, the pioneer and perfecter of our faith, who for the sake of the joy that was set before him endured the cross, disregarding its shame, and has taken his seat at the right hand of the throne of God. By the incredible power of God, Jesus pioneered something for us on that first Easter day. He had to endure the utter depravity and shame of being hung on a cross to secure my forgiveness and exchange places with me for all my wrongdoing. But to limit his achievements to that would be to seriously underestimate what God has done here. Jesus taught his disciples to pray for the kingdom to come. And now on Easter Day, it broke into life on this planet in no uncertain terms. All heaven broke through this tear in the fabric of creation that we call the resurrection. Jesus has shown hints of this earlier when Lazarus was brought back to life. But poor old Lazarus has to die again. The resurrection of Jesus Christ is fundamentally different. This tear in creation's fabric was an event through which God exacted his final plan to bring this world to completion. You can hear the joy in the angel's voice. He is not here, for he has been raised, as he said. Come, see the place where he lay. In the original language, the word resurrection is pronounced anastasis. It translates literally as standing up. Jesus is not a ghost, he is standing up. He is standing up because God, through Jesus, overthrew the dark powers that have spoiled and corrupted this beautiful world, and particularly the beautiful lives of human beings who are made to be the crown of creation, the agents through whom God would bring his beauty and his justice into this world. In resurrection, Jesus abolished the authority that death exercised over the old created order. Our passage ends. Suddenly Jesus met them. Greetings, he said. They came to him, clasped his feet, and worshipped him. A resurrection kind of faith does not arise from agreeing with biblical principles and evidences. It is the result of an unforgettable experience of meeting Jesus Christ, the risen Saviour. The women's faith was based upon their experience of meeting with Jesus. They actually clasped his feet. Jesus proved true to his words that when he said to Martha, "I am the resurrection and the life. Those who believe in me, even though they die, will live." Is that your experience too? Dare you ask Jesus to meet with you in a new and dynamic way today on this Easter day? In the last few days, NHS staff applauded Hilton Murray Phillipson as he was wheeled out of hospital, having made a remarkable recovery from coronavirus. Hilton publicly thanked the NHS and included those who had been praying for him. He said on interview, "I'm appreciating every little thing as if it is for the first time in my life." Here is a man giving witness on primetime news to the first time power of God, which is the only thing Jesus asked of the women that day, that first day of eternity. He said, "Go and tell my brothers, go and witness." In what way is the Lord asking you to become a standing up Christian like Hilton? I don't know what is going to come out of this difficult season we find ourselves in. What I do know is that the resurrection teaches us that Jesus is the linchpin, the God-man, the ultimate heaven and earth person, and the one who interlocks both of these realms in the future purpose of God. Ephesians 1 reminds us that Jesus gathers up things in heaven and things on earth. That is why Revelation chapter 21 speaks emphatically of heaven coming to earth. People have all sorts of ideas about death, rather like my earlier observations, and most of them are without much hope. The Christian who has resurrection faith is not afraid of death. We are called like Jesus by the power of the Holy Spirit to be linchpins between heaven and earth. And that means the earth and this creation still matters in God's economy with all that follows from that. Will you stand up with me as we bring this hope to the people in our community, as if it is the first day of a new season? It is a season when we can exercise confidence because we know Jesus and he is the mighty resurrection and the life that will utterly transform this generation. Amen.